Here we go.
Okay, why don't we go ahead and get started? Our distinguished guest today is she's an educator, and thanks to Jesse Yeager sitting down here in the front. Say hi, Jesse, to everybody. Thanks to Jesse for bringing her here this morning. We very much appreciate it. Nicole is an assistant professor of journalism at Ohio State University, as some of you saw from her vitae. She teaches lots of things there. She's been a member of the faculty for the teaching full-time for the last 5 years, and before that, she was an adjunct teaching magazine writing, which she still does in what little spare time that she does have. What she has done in the classroom is taking utilizing iPads and iTunes U to flip journalism courses to create a self-contained environment to do multimedia journalism. She's also produced two ebooks, interactive textbooks, and I love the titles of both of them with animals in both the titles. Always Get the Name of the Dog is one of them, on the art of effective interviewing. Always Get the Name of the Dog. And the other one is Writing Like Rabbits, a guide to creating and selling magazine articles. And her background is just as eclectic as the title of those two books. For 14 years, she was executive editor of Hoofbeats Magazine, which is the worldwide authority on the harness racing industry. She's also been a newspaper reporter and editor in Philadelphia, as well as wine country in California, and at one time worked for a congressman from the state of Pennsylvania. And for a basketball fan like me, I was interested in the fact that she once did publicity for the Philadelphia 76ers, the NBA team. And she even has a story about inviting Charles Barkley, when he was playing for the Sixers as a young man, to Thanksgiving one year with her family. She's a Philadelphia sports fan, as you might imagine. Some heartbreak yesterday at her house, the fact that they got creamed by the Dallas Cowboys. Obviously a sports fan of Ohio State University, where she's employed. I told her she needs to come back next year when the Buckeyes come to Norman and play the Sooners for the first time since 1983. So for now, let's give a nice, warm Sooner welcome to our special guest, Nicole Kraft. Nicole?
Switch myself on here, did that work? Okay. Hi, it is an absolute pleasure to be here. I am from Ohio State, so whenever you say OSU, I'm not sure what you're talking about, but I'm going to go with the Buckeyes on that one, because I think we'd all feel more affectionate toward an OSU in Ohio. I am really honored to be here today. I am an Apple Distinguished Educator, which means that I'm one of the people who has kind of stepped up to see what Apple products can do in order to advance education. And it's a fairly lengthy application process with a great deal of competition, so I'm incredibly honored to do that. But really the greatest honor comes from my ability to come here and be able to meet with you and be able to share with you what we're doing at Ohio State. And just really, I'd love to hear from you and make this more of a dialogue. I always joke when I do a talk like this that this is the most lecturing I will do at any given moment, because I don't lecture in any of my classes. And I don't do that because of the way that I've been integrating Apple technology into my courses and kind of really re-envisioning my courses since I was introduced to Apple. So the main things I want to talk about today are the college classroom has to train students like it's their first job. The entry-level jobs that we had in journalism don't exist anymore. And the expectation that we have for students now when they leave us and we launch them into the working world is they will be not only driven by the skill that we've instructed them, but they will act professionally, they will be able to think professionally, they won't make some of the stupid mistakes that I think any of us who grew up as journalists in the 80s and 90s, we were allowed to make. A key part of our teaching has to be preparing them to be those people. Secondarily, we have to think about how learning is conducted in today's environment, how students learn now, how students want to engage with material. We can't stop teaching them just because we finished our 55-minute class or 80-minute class or whatever it might be. And so our ability to really take teaching beyond the classroom is going to help drive their learning process. And then finally, we have to assume that students don't learn the way we did. It would be great. It would be so much easier for all of us if we took what experiences we had as learners and we moved that forward and we said, this is the most successful way of teaching. But what we do know is that teaching evolves over time, students evolve over time, and technology has changed everything about how our students consume information, how they seek out information, and how they will become learners, both in their collegiate environment and certainly moving forward, and we ultimately want them to be lifelong learners. So, you know, everybody who teaches journalism is familiar with this, and we've all taught the inverted pyramid. It's the first thing that I teach my students, despite the fact we move on from it fairly quickly. But the core concepts are the same, that the most important information comes first. And if we start to think about education the same way, of how we can engage them in an inverted way, in a way that puts the learning more in their response, in their wheelhouse, and really that's what the inverted pyramid does, is it makes us make consumers responsible for the information they're going to get. They're going to get it all in the first paragraph. And what we're going to do from a teaching standpoint is to flip our classrooms and think about the learner first and less about our own ability to convey information and more their ability to consume information. So, some of the research that we looked at before we started doing this, because if I'm going to do an academic presentation, I always want to bring in some research. Was looking at student interactions with courses and anticipating that behavior has to change for there to be growth. And when we facilitate this, we're looking for professors to start to ask themselves, how can I change what I do to better engage the students that I have in front of me? Now, how many of you were taught by lecture? I think we should all, at some point, we were all lecture. So how much fun was it to sit in an environment that I assure you was not nearly as nice as this one and be talked to for 55 minutes, 80 minutes? I actually just dropped a class I mentioned yesterday to Ed that was 2 hours and 45 minutes of someone lecturing at me. I was taking that class up until last Wednesday when I dropped it because I couldn't take it anymore. How many people have that experience in education? How many people feel that was the best way for them to be learning? So that's what we have to think about, is how do you learn better? We learn better didactically, we learn better. It really depends on the kind of learner that we are. And so what we're looking to do is to incorporate technology into how we learn so that it facilitates that learning. Not replacing it, that's not our goal, but we have to look at how each different person learns and whether we can present them with information in a way that will be retained and consumable. So we're looking at matching teaching styles with student learning styles ultimately. Now, for us, we have to start thinking about where students learn. This is where students learn. They find information digitally. And, you know, it's interesting, there are studies now looking at our idea of memory and how we remember things. We don't have to remember nearly as many things as we did because of Google, right? So a second we're not sure of something, we were trying to find out some character on a TV show, we Google it. We don't need to memorize things. And so how can we utilize a tool like this so that it will enable students to want to seek information that goes beyond what happened on season 3 of The Walking Dead and looks more at how they can do their jobs? We want to think about, I gotta move this thing because it certainly works better when I turn my head, how they seek out learning. So they're always seeking out some information, but the challenge for us is, although they are reliant on these devices, they don't fiddle the same way we did? Has anyone noticed that a student will ask you what seems to be a relatively rudimentary question about how do I find such and such or how do I learn to do something? There's a YouTube video for just about anything you need to know how to do, but students don't seek them out as much as we do if we don't teach them how to use their technology in a way that's beneficial to them. And we have to look at them becoming engaged. So how can we, in some way, utilize these tools to make them be engaged in their own learning? Because the passivity of learning is where we've really lost our students. That's where we, for some reason, our generation and the generations before us engaged in very passive learning, and we were okay with it. These students are not satisfied with that. So how can we utilize this technology to bring that learning together for them as our key? So these are my students. I'm very proud of them. This is my first iPad class. So I want to tell you a little bit about how I got introduced to iPads and why I decided to go in the direction that I did. And it all goes back to an email. Now, for our students, I don't know, your students blocking out email the same way mine are? We have to use different forms of communication. Well, I'm old school. I'm 47. And so for me, email was still working pretty well. And it was working super well in 2012 when I was at Ohio State. I'd been there for just under 2 years. And I got this email, and it was like that Gary Larson cartoon about what dogs hear, blah, 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 ginger. This said, blah, 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 free trip to Cupertino. So I don't honestly know what the rest of it said, but I got to go to Cupertino. I'm a California native. I was going to go home 45 minutes from home. And when I got there, actually, it was before 7 weeks before I left, they're like, oh, by the way, you have to make an iTunes U course if you're going to go to this event in Cupertino. I'm like, whatever. And I had no idea what it was, and it really didn't make any difference to me. You know, I was just looking at that week in January of going home. So I ended up, was teaching a new course in media law and ethics, and I started to develop the content, and they explained to me how I put it in the iTunes U course. I'm like, yeah, whatever. And I collect all these assets, and I put it all together, and I aspired to be one of the first person to publish a course, because I do like to be first. So I went out there and I created this course, and you know, it was interesting. Well, everyone else was sort of socializing and hanging out because Apple's really fun if you guys get a chance to go there, and they feed you a ton. So everyone's eating and drinking, and I'm there with my earphones in just like blasting Pearl Jam and just cranking this course out because I swear to God I'm going to publish it. And as I'm doing it, I realize I'm living the course while I'm putting it together. And I'm able to envision it from beginning to end and how I can see the sequencing of events, how I can see the assignments, where things are missing. And I'm really getting this three-dimensional view of my course in a way that I've never actually seen before. Because when I put the syllabus together, I hope it will work. But you know, you'll realize you'll get to the end of it. You're like, oh, crud, I meant to mention that in this class, but I forgot, and then I'm not going to mention it here. So I really started to see things differently. So I come home. I launch this course before we leave Apple. I was the second person to hit the button. And we go home. By the time I get back to Columbus, 8 hours later, I had 5,000 people enrolled in the course. And that course ended up going up to about 30,000 people. And I have issued several revisions of it. And I put it out in my class, although I only had about, I think, maybe 6 people with iPads out of 40. I'm like, why don't you guys try this and see what you think? So they started navigating the course materials that way, and they're like, this is awesome. This is completely comprehensive. I can move at whatever pace I want. I'm able to navigate all the information. I was still lecturing them, but they were engaging. The students that had the iPads and were using iTunes U, they were engaging in a way that the other students couldn't because they had so much more ability to prepare for what we were going to do. And it was engaging them because there was a calendar. They knew exactly what was due. It was fun. They were playing with their toys. We sat around. We had coffee. And I bought them all donuts. And we figured out how to make the iPad work better for them. And so it was a completely different experience that led me to apply for a grant to put iPads in a classroom. We had a grant process at Ohio State. And I was the first winner of what we called the Digital First Impact Grant. So for $25,000, I put an iPad in the hands of everybody in this news writing class. And I designed an iTunes U course for them. I wrote the textbook, Always Get the Name of the Dog, which because I figured interviewing was the one thing everybody was going to need to know how to do. And we sent them off with the hypothesis that if I could train them with iPads to do everything, consume all their class materials, take notes, shoot photos, write stories, do their research, reach out to sources, that they would learn better, faster, and stronger, and more effectively than if I just relied on them to use conventional technology. Lost track of my little button here. All right, so these are the courses that I've subsequently created. There's 5 that are being utilized in my classes now, and I'm going to show you the behind the scenes of them a little bit. I teach immersion reporting, which is an enterprise reporting class, semester-long, single project reporting class. That Media Law and Ethics course, I've now revised it 4 times. And what I do now is I create a public course that goes out into the world that I have about 110,000 subscribers to all of these courses. And then for every class, I create a private one because iTunes U allows me to do private things with them that I don't want to do publicly, including article submission, grading. It allows me to have private discussions with them. So this has basically incorporated our classroom into one piece of apparatus. And no matter when we want to communicate with each other, whether they want to be working on a story, send it to me while they're doing it. I literally have people sending me things. They were working on their stories yesterday that are due today. So they were out in the field reporting, sending me their article drafts on the iPad. I was editing them. We do things with Google Drive, and then I send them back. And so our response time is now immediate, as opposed to our more conventional ways of doing things. Each one of these courses operates similarly but differently. The always get the name of the dog one is intended to guide people through the book. So it helps people with interviewing, but it's not really structured to a course. So sometimes I make courses that are just informational. I make courses that only have one subject to them. So if we just want to talk about how to do data-driven journalism, I'll just do a segment on data-driven journalism and create a private course for them. So this gives me a lot of navigation in terms of putting together a kind of a collection for them, a how-to sometimes, and it allows them to navigate the material no matter where they are. As Ed mentioned, I also wrote a couple books, Always Get the Name of the Dog and Writing Like Rabbits. Writing Like Rabbits is actually, I think it was John Steinbeck who said that magazine articles are like rabbits. You get magazine ideas, you get a few of them together, and pretty soon you have a million of them. So that's what I do in the real world when I still write. I'm a professor of practice, is what you would probably call it here. We call them clinical. So I write magazine articles pretty much every minute of the day. I'm doing something that relates to a magazine article. So to me, it was really important that these books do 2 things. One, I needed them to have the information I needed them to have. And most textbooks, how many of you are using a textbook now in your journalism courses? Okay, do anyone know what year that textbook was written in? Do you know what year that was written in? When? Okay, so what do you think has changed in 2 years? Anything? Right, and I mean, we talk about the web, but of course, Wired said the web's dead. What's live now? Mobile. So the idea of where our phones would take us was completely not considered 2 years ago. And that's my point, is that these books change constantly. I can update this book. We could literally be standing here right now while I update this book, and they're going to get a push notification that I changed something about it while they're navigating it this semester. So there's no more waiting for a new edition. There's no more requiring them to buy. The thing that freaked me out most and why I wrote this magazine writing book is it was a $60 book. I think the thing was 128 pages, the textbook that I had for them, and it was $60. I'm like, you have got to be kidding me. So this book is $1.99. Both of them are $1.99 on the iTunes store, and at the end of the semester, I take them all out for pizza, and so we reinvest in the only way that I think matters to them, which is food. We also have incorporated a ton of apps in what we do. Now, I introduce them to as many apps as I think might be useful to them. Some of these may be familiar to you, and some of them may not be. But no matter what we approach, we look at each one of it, we figure out how it works for us, whether or not it works for us, is it something we need to continue using, how will we use it, and is it something that could be utilized in a different way. So, for example, I use the owl up there is Hootsuite. Does anyone else use Hootsuite? All right, so we can have them, you know, Twitter does certain things, Hootsuite does certain things. Do we use them both? Do we use one or the other? We have to really figure out ways that are beneficial. We use social media a lot in my classes, which I'll show you in a second. So I'm showing them how we can navigate Twitter in a multitude of different ways using different tools. We use Evernote, depending on people's level of interest in Macs in general. Evernote allows you to sync notes across all of your Apple devices. But some people prefer to use Pages. I prefer to use Notability. Does anyone use Notability? Greatest app in the world. Don't scratch that part, because it's actually Explain Everything, who one of my fellow ADEs invented. So we're all supposed to talk about that one. But no, just kidding. But the one up here, Explain Everything, allows me to basically have a whiteboard inside my iPad that I can do lecture capture in, I can navigate, I can annotate slides. I can do whatever I want mobily while I'm walking around and record all of it. So there's an amazing opportunity for us. We do podcasting, so this little star over there, and of course GarageBand. The AP Stylebooks, anyone using the AP Stylebook app? Yeah. What a great invention that was. How many times have you searched for the same thing over and over again and dog-eared your pages or put, you know, or carried that ridiculous book around with us? And if you didn't get the spiral one, you were screwed. So this idea of having the app has enabled them to really exponentially improve their AP style because of their ability to look things up much more easily and in a way that's more beneficial to them. Got a few more for you. Videolicious. So this is us out in the field on our first photo assignment that we did day before yesterday. So we all went out, and the first thing that we did is we took pictures. And while we were out in the field, we analyzed them. And we said, what's working about this picture? Who took it? What was your view? Think about how differently this is. And so the tall kid in the back, your picture of exactly the same thing looks much different than my picture because I'm much shorter than you are. So let's talk about perspective. Let's talk about what happens when the sun, this is actually, there's a window over here. And so they all, I said, go just take a picture. Just for the first time, just go take one. And so they all do it with the window, with the light coming in. And their faces, which of course you know is the worst possible thing you can do. They're like, oh my God, these people are all, I can't see anything, it's all dark. And I'm like, isn't that incredible what happens when you put light on your subject? And then we talked about aperture, and we talked about how your camera responds to light. And they were able, within a 15-minute span, to go out and shoot photos that actually were published on the Lantern website within the next hour. So they went out, and I said, everyone go take a photo that's going to be of some news value to someone, and let's see what you come back with. And what they came back with after we had a few 15 minutes worth of lessons were publishable pictures. And think about how much slower that process would have been had I given them an assignment and then required them to turn that assignment in and then had it come in. We don't have time to wait when it comes to news. We have to be nimble. We have to be moving constantly. And this idea of this flipped classroom, of being able to bring the lectures offline, offline or online, depending on how you look at it. My students take their lectures home, and they watch them there. They're no more than 5 minutes. And I give them instruction, basic core instruction of how to build a foundation of knowledge. And they get supporting links, and they're able to kind of feel their way through a topic. Then they come in, and we talk about that foundation. And we make sure that that foundation is sound enough to support whatever work they're going to do. And then we work. So every single class period is dedicated to doing an activity of some sort that is meant to gear them toward publication. We don't waste time. I'm a big person. I can't waste time. It drives me insane to do things just because I said so. So if we're going to cover something, it's going to be something that's publishable. If we're going to shoot a photo, it's with the intention of getting it published. And the more accountability that I put on them, the better that they seem to respond. There's us working on our iPads in class on an assignment. Super cute. We're incorporating all sorts of technology into what we do, and I think part of what we need to think of as instructors is how does technology engage them? So a new assignment that I'm starting this semester, I teach media law, and as Ed mentioned yesterday, you know, how do you make media law interesting? Because did anyone take media law? And what did we do in that class? Do you remember? Did we memorize a lot of court cases? Yes. Somebody stood there and told us about the court cases and what the circumstances. What's that? You don't have to, but how many of us took the class that way? All right, so I took it as an undergrad and in grad school. In fact, I took over the class from the guy that taught me in grad school. So now, we don't do any of that. We don't spend time where I tell them about court cases. I give them a 5-minute lecture on a particular topic. So for example, we did libel day before yesterday, or whatever, or Thursday. So we did libel. And they got a basic idea of what libel is, and the criteria for libel, and some of the cases that influence libel. And then when they come in, we talk about those cases. So tell me about Hustler versus Falwell, or tell me about whatever case, maybe if, you know, we talked about Wayne Newton and his libel case. And then I give them an assignment where I say, look, these are 6 real libel cases. You're divided up into 6 different teams and split in half each team. One side is defending against this libel charge, one side's bringing the libel charge. And now you need to tell me which cases that you learned about are going to apply to this case. And which aspects of libel does this fit? And is this person a public figure, a public official? Are they a limited purpose? Are they a private person? You need to tell me and build, basically, your side of this argument. And then the two of them will base, those two sides will debate each other, utilizing these cases. Now, that's not necessarily a technology-driven approach. That's a thinking approach. And that gives them the opportunity to apply what they've learned And if they can't apply it, they can't do the assignment. So they have to get the foundation. Now, I bring up this podcasting because as a final in the class that I took, you had to write a paper about a court case. Now, you know, I don't know about you guys. I got pretty good at writing papers by the end of it. I don't even remember what the paper was about, and it wasn't that long ago. So instead, what we've done is we're actually doing a research project where you can pick the paper if you want to, and we'll give you all the instructions on what we need you to write, or you can create a podcast from the perspective of a Supreme Court justice. And you can say, I am this justice. I'd love if they pick Clarence Thomas since he's only said 7 words in the last 7 years. But so you're going to pick this Supreme Court justice, and you are going to create a podcast talking about the case that I assign you, what's your background, what's this case, what are the circumstances, what research would you have done into it, what are the precedent cases, what did you decide, how did you decide it? And I want to see whether or not they end up collaborating more, which is what I'm seeing so far. They're like, hey, can we get together and do this as what the assignment is, to how they can incorporate it, how they can expand on the experience, because it's something that they want to engage in. And that's a far different experience than something that they have to get through. I like that picture. That's why I put it in there. All right, so we use as many platforms as I feel is reasonable for them to consume and places where they would naturally go. So we do use Facebook, although many students do not go to Facebook. We certainly know that the numbers drop off when they're in high school and college, pick up again when they're post-college. And I just had my 30-year high school reunion. They're still posting pictures for that. I'm a little nauseated by it, but we'll get past it. So what we do is we post a lot of articles here and re-engage. They're contributing things on this Facebook page that will help us better understand the issues that they're dealing with now. And I have one of those for every class. We also use Instagram, of course. So we're using as many different technologies as we can to see what sticks. So Instagram is now sticking more than it did 2 years ago. And Snapchat is something that we're all engaging in now because it's something that's relevant. Last semester, we did Periscope. So what we're trying to see is how can we bring the information to them. This is Periscope, but I actually just presented on how you can use Periscope for live assignments. And we also, of course, build in the ethics of that. So what's the ethics of broadcasting something live? Is anyone broadcasting us live here? You're broadcasting us live with Periscope?
Oh, no.
Wouldn't that be awesome?
What?
Oh, that's quite right. So what are the ethics of contributing in these ways? What can we take off of? I just had a student who had a photo of hers that was on her Facebook page that a magazine in town actually pulled it off and utilized it without her permission, without any credit. And so, you know, what is the legality of that? What are the ethics related to that? So we're trying to build the whole package into it so they can see this is where resources are, this is where people get information, and this is what you need to know before you're going to go and use it. We're all using Snapchat now and contributing to Snapchat stories. And we're actually doing something pretty cool through the Apple Distinguished Educator Program. We've partnered with a high school in Chicago that's also using Snapchat, and we're doing Snapchat assignments together. We've actually created a program called You Inspire. Get it? You? Anyway. There's people who are at higher ed level, and we're partnering with high schools. So I'm partnering with this one in Chicago. My colleague in Oregon, Ed Martin, is partnering with another school in New Mexico. And we're doing projects together. So what we're trying to do is to learn from each other, yes, but also see how maybe our teaching styles can meet the needs that we have so that higher ed and K-12 can integrate better so that our students are better prepared when they come up from K-12 and that we're actually, we think that we're going to be less prepared because they come from K-12, but in fact, from a technological standpoint, they're far ahead of where many professors are. So we need to see what is their familiarity and how can we integrate what we're doing. And then we use Twitter. How many of you are using Twitter in your classes? Can you tell me how you're using Twitter in your classes? Anybody? Don't be those students that don't talk. That would make me sad.
We have people, we have people, guests are going to be on your shows.
Okay.
And you know, who they're interviewing and who maybe is going to do a live performance on your shows.
Great. So are they doing it from their own personal account?
Right.
Okay. Or do you use hashtags to connect that? Or?
I'm not.
Okay. Anyone else using Twitter? Yes. Yes.
Okay. I'm just using it in a very general way in introduction to mass communication class in a sort of helping them to get to know each other, get to know me to know them.
So what do they do?
I mean, I just encourage them to follow me.
Okay.
And I'll follow them. I encourage them to use the, we have a hashtag, Go Gaylord, to follow the college. So we're just, at the moment, we're just using it as introductory.
Great. Awesome. Anybody else? Yeah.
Just trying to get eyes on. Mm-hmm. We're promoting our story, and that's how we're using it.
Okay. So how do you do that? They send them out from their own private account?
Links to the stories.
Okay.
It's on the United page, or it's on a Roots TV thing, or when they're, when they've completed their stories. But I imagine there are many other ways they should be using it.
Okay.
I thought of something else, too. We
sure. Great.
And so I'll be asking them to use it for self-promotion of their blogs, and then again, connecting with each other, promoting each other's work.
Excellent. So the thing that we know about social media is you can use it for good or you can use it for evil. And what we try to do is to teach them how to use it for good. Now, social media in general, because it is by definition social, is a give and a take. And what we find is that most students take. And so taking means look at what I've put out there. Look at my thoughts. Listen to me. And there's very little give in terms of what would you like to see, or how can we better engage with each other, or here's a question that I really want to know the answer to and you can provide it. So we try to build it in a way that will teach them to make it part of their lives in a responsible way. I joke with them, I'm their Twitter fairy, and so I monitor every student that I have, and I monitor their Twitter accounts. And that doesn't mean that I'm on there jumping on when they say something that I dispute, but if I do see that they're posting things consistently that I find to be troubling or would be potentially hazardous to them in a job search, I will say, this is your Twitter fairy. I don't know that I would have said that. Or the one kid who put out there that he had some 27-year-old student sitting next to him who must be the stupidest student at the university since he didn't know the answer and he was a 27-year-old freshman. I'm like, hey, have we ever heard of libel? Because you can actually identify this kid by the only 27-year-old freshman that you have in your class. So what we're trying to do is to build up their digital responsibility. Now, the first thing that we do is show them what a relatively decent page looks like. Now, I don't mean to toot my own horn, but, I have a cover picture that in some way reflects me. I have, thank God, a professional picture that Bill Frakes, who's a very acclaimed photographer, takes of all Apple Distinguished Educators. What does your Twitterography say about you? The fact that Twitterographies are searchable, so that little biography that you have 160 characters, not 140, you have 160 over there to say something about yourselves. Hashtags, at symbols, all of those things make it increasingly searchable. That's one of the ways that Twitter will find those people recommended for you. So how do you become one of those people who's recommended? What tweets do you put out about yourself? What website do you put? Do you have a website? How can you look at your Twitter feed as something that other people would want to engage with? Because that, of course, is the whole goal of social media, is to get people to want to follow you either follow you as followers on Twitter, to follow you on Instagram, to follow you on Snapchat, to be your friends on Facebook. There has to be an incentive for people to do that. So in addition to tweeting well, we actually use this as a pretty significant communication device. So my students tweet their attendance, and they tweet something that we're doing in class. Now, so I am not that person that says, put your device away. Quite the contrary. I want you to utilize your device when it's something that is useful to you. So they'll tweet their attendance. It has to be something that's significant to what's happening in class. Every class has a class hashtag. And here's an example of a student who was sick who followed our entire class while she's homesick on Twitter. And she was engaging with us on Twitter despite the fact she had a fever of 104. I also get students to say things that they wouldn't say to me personally. So it's amazing what they tweet out about how I didn't understand anything that we talked about. They won't say that to me, but they will say that on Twitter because they feel a level of anonymity. And in that point, I can engage with them and say, hey, let's talk about this. What didn't you understand? How can I make this more clear for you? Or they'll say things like, I'm freaking out. And so, okay, let's talk about that. Let's figure out how we can make this a better experience for you. They really do want to get help, but their level of communication for communication students is a struggle. How many of you have seen a decline in people coming to your office hours? Yeah. I mean, that's a big effort for them to come to your office hours. So I have office hours on Twitter. We actually have a Twitter chat that we do on a given night of the week, and it changes depending on the semester, depending on what else is going on, but we'll always have a time where we're utilizing a hashtag that they can go and get answers when they need them. We also realize that we can reach anyone. So I don't know if any of you are familiar with Ron Galella. He is a photographer, but best known, of course, for stalking Jackie Kennedy. I teach media law and ethics in film. So we watch movies related to ethical issues and legal issues, absence of malice, all the president's men. Among them, we watched Smash His Camera, which is a documentary about Ron Galella. He's quite a personality. So while my students were tweeting about the film, Ron Galella started engaging with us. And in fact, he's coming in as a guest speaker this semester because he was so engaged with the things that we were talking about. So this idea that it's a one-way discussion can get dispelled pretty quickly. I mentioned to Ed and Jesse last night that I'm friends with Jake Tapper, who is on CNN, and he was at ABC, of course, and he and I used to work together. So when he was on the Oval covering President Obama during the reelection campaign, he was tweeting from the Oval. I said, I'm teaching a course right now. He said, I'll be there in 5 minutes. And then Jake Tapper, who was the ABC White House correspondent at that point, trots across the Oval and comes to visit us. So the access that we now have to people that we didn't have before is astounding if we use this properly. This is my greatest tweet of all time because Michael Bolton tweeted at me. This is from the ADE thing. Okay, we also do games. So this is an example of a Twitter game that we do that helps them develop story ideas.
Pin the Tail on the Donkey has long been a childhood birthday staple, but what if we took it out of the party room and put it into the classroom? That's the idea behind Pin the Tail on the Campus, an iPad-based journalism game. All it takes is a blindfold and an iPad, some reporting apps, and post-it note tails with a map of campus. And students have an hour to find, report, and tweet out story ideas.
You will get sources, and you will interview one person for your story.
Today.
All of that today.
All of that today.
Students start their quest with a blindfold and a spin in a circle before they reach forward to place their tail upon the map. Once their location's identified and their name was written on the tail, they head out in teams to find their story, armed only with their iPads.
I thought it was a really cool experience. Being able to actually start with the Pin the Tail on the Campus was really cool. I love birthday party games. It was just an interesting way to go out of your comfort zone.
The location.
So the idea is really simple. We took something that they're all familiar with and we said, look, we're going to make it fun, but now you have to go work. So after I blindfold them and spin them around, they have 55 minutes to go out, find a story idea, tweet it to me, I approve it or don't. They have to find another one if I don't approve it. They get sources, they research it, they report it, and they write a minimum of 3 paragraphs on that story, including a quote from a source, before they come back into class. Actually, they don't come back into class. That's the rest of the class period. So I monitor them on Twitter while they do that, and I engage with them on their idea. So, and then they come back in the next day, and they write the rest of the story, and then they submit that to the student newspaper. Now, are they all great? No. But what it's got them working on is A, a deadline, B, understanding what news value is, C, being able to work in a team, D, they have to use multimedia. Everything has to have a photo. Everything has to have a video shot with it. They're doing interviewing. They're taking notes out in the world. They're doing their research. So all of their skill level is being developed in one game for them. So it's another aspect of the gamification of what we can do. And what we're seeing is that students are much more engaged in their learning experience by doing our teaching this way. We actually finished a research paper that was, I don't think I'll ever write another research paper because I literally did one research project. I wrote one article. I submitted it to one journal. It was accepted by that one journal with one revision. Then I presented it at a conference, the first conference I tried to go to. I submitted it and they accepted it. And then someone else picked it up from there and it was named a top paper at another conference. So I don't know exactly if it's supposed to work like this. I don't care because I'm going with it. But what it's shown us is that people are really desperate to figure out how this works. And we've shown that it makes our students better, stronger, and faster, which of course was the hypothesis we came at in the first place. That by giving them ownership over their education, by making it something that doesn't feel like a burden and more of an opportunity, that we are able to get them to participate in ways that we hadn't anticipated before. That they are getting more information, more articles published more quickly. The record that we had on the first semester was within 3 weeks we had someone published. The second semester we did this, we had people published in the first 2 weeks of class. And this semester, we had people published in the very first week of class by Friday. We had someone with a story published in our student newspaper. Now, you know, what's amazing about it is that they're getting enough information to be able to do that. And they're doing it because the technology has expanded learning to the point that they can do it where they want, when they want, how quickly they want, and they can engage much more rapidly. So I'm happy to pass on our research if anyone's interested. This is some of the feedback that we've gotten from our students in terms of what they think about the flipped class, what they liked about it. I've now flipped all of my classes. I teach 4 classes a semester. They are all done in this inverted format. All of my students are, they don't all have iPads. I just have the one class with iPads. But I'm actually at the point that the other classes that I do not provide iPads in, I'm up to 50% iPads. So when I have students who don't have iPads, I try to recreate the experience for them as best I can. I utilize Storify, so I'll create the entire course as a Storify document. Is anyone using Storify? That's it's an aggregation tool for things that are on the web. You can bring in tweets, Facebook posts, YouTube videos, any website. And so I bring in all the videos from YouTube. I bring in all the links that I would have had in iTunes U, and they can navigate the course that way. It's not nearly as seamless as the experience that we have on iTunes U. I really miss the calendar in terms of submitting their assignments. We still have to submit them in other ways. So we use Google Drive for those classes, or we use Dropbox. So we're still using apps, and we're still using technology, and we're still trying to create the experience as much as we can, but recognizing that if you don't have iPads, iTunes U is unfortunately limited for us.
I think
this is what our students say. Whoops, I'd let them talk.
I think one thing I love most about it is that in class, like, you obviously have class the same days, every day of the week at the same time, and I don't know, if you're sometimes kind of tired and maybe you're not, like, retaining information as well as you would have another time, I just love being able to do it on my own time when I feel really focused and I'm, you know, ready to watch this lecture and take it in, and I found that I've felt like I've taken in even more information. Then I can go back, and, like, just this weekend, I went back and referred to which states were needed 2 parties to consent to recording, and which ones needed 1 party.
The iPads made it really easy to do everything at once in this class, especially when we had to do our multimedia projects. Just not having to go to a computer lab, having the iPad right there, and having the iMovie app to put everything together made the transition from taking prereq classes to my first journalism class a lot easier.
Using the iPad has been really good for being able to incorporate all the different parts of journalism, whether that's using Twitter, taking pictures, doing video, writing the article. For example, writing an article on a player on the men's hockey team, I was able to get video of him, I was able to take notes, I was able to record that interview, and it's all contained in one device, so I can just go back and use that. And another great part about the iPad is that it's mobile. You can take it with you. I don't need to be setting up my laptop everywhere I go. If I want to tweet something out real quick, tweet out a quick video, I can do it, boom, I'm done, move on to the next step.
So this is the first story that we had published from that iPad class. And I end with this because it was kind of brings all of it together. So the student that I showed you first, Carly Frank, she came into class in the third week, it was a Tuesday, and she said, I think there's something happening at the Ohio Union. There's this huge line of people. So I'm like, all I said was go, like, take your iPad and go and let us know what's going on. So she goes there and she tweets to us that there's a ticket release for this USA-Mexico game, and they had tried to give out the tickets and it was all screwed up, and so now they had this huge line of people trying to get tickets for this World Cup qualifying game. I said, okay, who do you need to talk to? Okay, so we need to talk to the people, and this is all through Twitter. We need to talk to people who are in charge of the ticket release. We need to talk to students who had gotten kind of screwed over with the first ticket release. We need to talk to students who are in line now. We need to figure out what the news is. So she's out there reporting, and as she has questions, she's tweeting back to us during class, and we're monitoring what she's doing. She ends up doing all of her interviews standing at the union. She gets in touch with every person she needs within that hour. We were in class for 55 minutes. She does all of her reporting during that time frame. She takes this picture from the second floor of the union because she said, I took a picture, I can't get the whole crowd. And someone else in class tweets back and is like, have you thought about going up to the second level and getting that perspective? So they started helping each other. Then she shoots a video and she interviews people and she gets the line and she gets people getting tickets and we advise her on where to shoot the video and ask permission to go behind the counter and all of these things. And within an hour, she had a draft of this story that I edited for her. And within 2 hours, this story was on the front page of our website, thelantern.com. And the next morning, this was on the front page of the student newspaper. So to me, that's what sums up what we're trying to get accomplished. We need people to produce professional quality material. We need people to engage in their learning. We need people to learn the skills in college that they will need to become functioning journalists, communicators, lawyers, doctors, teachers, whatever it's going to be, whatever they decide to become. They can learn that in our major and be able to take that out and be successful in whatever they decide to do. and utilizing technology in a way that is integrated in our learning, that complements the skills that we're trying to develop in them, will help them learn better, faster, and stronger. And it will make them be the kind of people who produce quality like this, who ends up going on to an internship at Apple. That's where she spent the summer. The other guy in that video, James Grega, he went on to become a sports reporter. He's working right now covering the Buckeyes. These are people who get jobs because they have the skills that we need them to have before they ever leave us.
I think one thing I love...
Oops. We can go through it again because it was so great. And I thank you. Yes. She did. No, she didn't come back. She wrote it right there in the student union. She did not come back to us at all. Yeah. She literally stood with her iPad. There's like a little bench thing, and she set her iPad up, and she typed the whole story out. She sent it to me. I edited it for her. She did the revision, and then she submitted it to our student editors. Any questions? Yes.
Three-part question.
Okay.
You can make real good use of this. Okay, one, at the first you said students today don't learn like we do. If you were going to say answer that, sum that up in, say, five sentences or less, if you could do that. Two, I was very glad to see you're teaching students to think about the practicalities of libel basics, because if, you know, obviously you can become a top editor at Rolling Stone and not know the bare minimum of libel law.
Clearly.
But I was a little concerned. You mentioned Hustler versus Falwell, not really a libel case. What cases do you use? And then three, have you...
Well, I encourage you to check out my iTunes U course so you can see all the cases that I use. We do talk about parody, though, as a defense against libel, because they do ask me about The Onion and Mad Magazine, how they get away with that thing. So that's the example that we use when it comes to parody.
And that would be the Two Live Crew case. That would be over in fair use law. But anyway... and then three, have you used this in any large classes? These seem like small skills classes. Have you used it in any large concept classes?
The biggest classes that I teach are, I range from 18 to 56 students. So that's the maximum number that I've taught them in. So going from your third question first. In terms, I encourage you to look out the iTunes U course because it's pretty extensive in terms of what we cover and all the cases that we cover and the extended material. So you'll see all the, literally from beginning to end, you can experience that course today. So every lecture, every link, every assignment that we have, all of that is engaged in that course right now. In terms of how students learn much more, it needs to be immediately connectable to them. They need to feel that they are experiencing something that is useful to them right now. They do not think in terms of someday this will be useful to me or I'm going to learn this theoretic concept. They have a very difficult time appreciating why they're experiencing a liberal arts education. And so one of the things that we need to show them in the midst of their liberal arts education is how they can utilize things and apply it right now and how it's something that will be useful to them. So that's what we try to incorporate. I don't replace a liberal arts education for them. I'm the skills part of their liberal arts education. And so for them to be able to see immediate application is key to their engagement in material. Does that answer your question? I teach skills classes.
When you were talking about the pin the tail on the campus exercise, one of the things, and this is a broader question than just that game, one of the concerns that I always have is if they just go out and do it and they haven't heard the lecture about news values and what makes a news story and they don't understand different types of sources to interview, I would think they'd go out and they'd have fun doing it, but that everything that came back would be crap.
Well, we don't do this in the first. In fact, we're doing it tomorrow. So we start the fifth week tomorrow.
So they have heard either a podcast.
We do this. I mean, all of these things are intended to be they're building blocks. So, you know, the first thing that they did, I had sent them out on the first day, and I'm like, find me a story. And so they came back with stories, and then we broke down, okay, based on the 8 criteria of news, does this fit? Is this a real story? So we look at news value, and it's like, all right, here's the, and we're going to put a check mark next to each one, and we're going to see whether or not this story has news value. So we discovered the people who were walking around campus with their baby because he was going back to school and, you know, she was going to be a stay-at-home mom, not really news. So, but the story about the guy who had just gotten back from Afghanistan and how he was taking his first course in education because he now wants to become a kindergarten teacher, that might be news. So understanding that. So that's the first thing that we do. And then we start to build AP style. And then we start to build on how you write the inverted pyramid. And then we build from there. So now they've already submitted their first article to me. And they know, hey, this was successful. These are the things that work. These are the things we need to work on. Now they're going out to find their next story idea this way. Yes.
You mentioned Periscope. I'm curious as to how you might use Periscope and Meerkat. And you also kind of touched on the legality and so forth. Can you explore that a little bit?
Yeah, so the first thing I do, and again, a lot of these things are, most of us of our generation, we learn by fiddling. And so I'm trying to incorporate that into how they learn things too. So as I said, the first thing I do is send them out to find any story idea, and then we'll figure out if it works. I send them out on the first thing, and I say, live stream something. And I want to see what you're going to come back with in live stream. And I actually have some of my students from other classes come in. We monitor all the streams that they're doing. And we start to see, okay, I'm bored. Like, and they'll see, of course, the number of followers that they get will go up to 8, if they're lucky, and then it'll drop down to 1. And so why is it that it's not engaging? How long can you engage with something before people stop watching it? What is it that you're showing them that will make them actually engage with it? So once they do that, we come back and we evaluate, because we use Periscope because we can have 24 hours to evaluate that material. So the next day we're going to come in and we're going to say, okay, you guys streamed this. You held the thing horizontally, which doesn't work in Periscope. So you got to figure out how you're doing it. Hey, you have a lot of headroom here. Hey, you're shooting this from really far away. I can't tell what's going on. Hey, you're doing this. Hey, this one's great. Look how you had this many viewers. This is what worked. Why did this one work? Why are you guys more compelled with this? And then we'll send them out again and we'll have them cover something live. So Joe Biden came to campus last week. So they went out and they Periscoped Joe Biden coming. Or we'll send them out to a football practice or one of our other athletic events and we'll have them do an interview and we'll have them Periscope that. So at that point, we start to connect the Periscoping to their assignments. So you're going to be doing your next story on the construction on 18th Avenue and the fact that the road's been closed. We need you to go up there. We need you to Periscope what's going on 18th Avenue. Show us the construction. Interview some students. And now we're starting to see what the impact is if we do something that people are actually willing to watch.
So in a news context, there's no releases and no forms and so forth. But in an entertainment context, we're always releasing everybody for everything that we do. So I think in one respect you've got a nice situation there where you just set up and shoot. But I think for some of our purposes we've got to go through the legal forms and so forth to get released to make sure that we don't have any coming to bite us later.
I mean, we go through in terms of what's public and what's not. So if anyone's going into a bathroom and Periscoping, we're going to have some pretty serious problems. We make sure that doesn't take place. But, you know, where can you go to the library and do that? Can you go into someone's classroom and do that without permission? We discuss what's ethically sound, what's legally sound before they ever go out and do it. It's interesting. They're very timid, to be honest with you. They're much less inclined to do, they'd be much more inclined to live stream you from here than they would be to get right up in your face and do it. So it's more encouraging them to actually get involved in something than it is to have them step back from it. They seem to be very comfortable stepping back. That's another thing that goes into teaching them. They don't have the same innate curiosity that a lot of us had academically and certainly from a career standpoint. They want to be taught things. I want you to teach me how to do this. And I'm like, why don't you try it and see what works and what doesn't work? It's like the photos. I can tell them till I'm blue in the face, don't shoot with the light coming toward you. But until they actually do it, they're like, well, crap, that was a great. In fact, one of my students came in, she's like, I had this great picture, except the light was coming toward me, and now the image is so dark, you can't tell what it is. And I'm like, well, what did we learn from this? So, you know, they need to experience that. And being able to build those experience in, to be able to build failure into what we do. They don't like to fail. And no one does. But they've been taught their entire lives that failure is not an option. And God forbid, I mean, my son, you know, he's entering in his freshman year in high school. And I can't tell you how many people said to him, this is the rest of your life. This is your permanent record. Don't screw it up. And I'm like, my God, screw up now. Like, if you're gonna screw up, do it now. I'm totally cool with that. Before you're out there with a mortgage and a kid and all these other responsibilities. So we build failure into things. I want them to screw up.
Morbid, cataclysmic situation that they may fall into. Do you think that has quashed their curiosity?
Yes, most definitely. And I think that's our responsibility at the higher ed level to put it back in them. I think this is a whole other soapbox, but we have standardized tested their creativity completely out of them. And we have said, your ability to think and extrapolate thought is a detriment to you. And I think we have a responsibility as higher ed educators to put that back into their lives. And that's in part what this does. Because now they come up with things that I never even dreamed of. Yeah, a third of the apps that we use are things that other students have come up with. So let them be the teachers as well as the learners, because we're all going to learn better if we give them that latitude.
I have a grading issue. We do 4 blogs in my class. The university have been very, very good to my class. They've given them all iPads, so they all. I'm going to just a minute. they get to do 4 blogs. They're going to do 4 video assignments. We do 4 media critiques.
When you say 4 blogs, you mean 4 posts?
4 posts. Yes. Okay. And the university has given them all domains, so they can post to their domains. We use in class when we have a guest speaker. We use Today's Meet so we can aggregate questions. It's a class of freshmen. They don't like to raise their hands in front of their peers, so we use Today's Meet, and we can kind of aggregate the questions. My problem is I have 276 students in the class. The consequence of that is grading.
Mm-hmm.
I try to give them a rubric for everything we do so that they know what they're supposed to do and know how they're graded, but it's extremely difficult.
What's your use of undergraduate TAs or graduate
one.
TAs?
I have one.
You have one, okay. So I'm using undergraduate TAs for things that are more participatory. So the majority of the technology things that I require of them are participation as opposed to a point or letter grade. So I want them, that's part of the idea that you can fail. If you turn in a video, it may be the worst video I've ever seen in my life. If you do it and we learn from it, you have accomplished what I've asked you to do. So the things that are graded assignments are, there's probably 6 graded assignments in each course. But we do something every single day. So my students also blog, and each one of them has a blog with their own domain, and they're responsible. After every article that they write, they need to in some way augment it with their blog. I don't grade that as part of the assignment, but it is part of their participation grade. Every assignment that they do in some way is either, it's all pass, fail, it's complete or not complete. And if you complete them, you're going to get credit for it.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Well, how do you grade participation? I mean, what percentage of the grade is participation?
It depends on the class. So on average, it'll be between 10 and 15% will be participation. So, for the Periscope assignment, so for example, them going out and doing this thing tomorrow, the pin the tail on the campus, if you do it, you will get 100% participation for that particular one. And then each one of them in my own gradebook has points that doesn't show up on the university gradebook that they look at. So I'm going to assign them 10 points for that. Say there's a maximum of 150 points that are going to go into class participation. And then for every assignment that they do, they're going to get 10 points up to the 15 assignments that we'll do. But that's only for me, not for them.
The ultimate challenge for digital education with large classes online is developing some legitimate and fair means of assessment. It's to me, it's the biggest challenge of all. Content is not nearly as much of a challenge, in my view. And I don't know if you have any more ideas on that or not. As David said, it's really hard with large classes.
I understand that, and I'm the first one to admit what I don't do, and I don't teach large classes. So in terms of what I can tell you in terms of assessment for 200 people, I recognize that it's not exactly the same, but to a degree, all of these things are scalable because really it's not the mechanism of utilizing the device that's gradable. It's the end product of what they come up with. So, every student has to write an article. Whether they do that with me conventionally lecturing to them using a chalkboard and chalk, the end product has to be the same, of an article that is consumable by the public. It's intended for readers and not for me, which is a big stumbling block that we have, is to create content that's for the world and not just what's going to serve my purposes. Now they have to utilize technology with it, so everything has to have a photo, everything has to have a video, there has to be an aspect of social media in it. It's the end product, it's not how we get there, although all of those things are building blocks to this end product. But my goal for them is, in my law class, that they be able to, as journalists or whatever they decide to go into, to understand, hey, this is what news gathering is all about, and these are the legal rights that you have. And hey, if you burn a source, you may actually be criminally liable for that, depending on how you do it. And hey, if you cross a police tape, you know, I used to go on ride-alongs all the time when I was a cops reporter. Well, you know, you don't do that anymore. I mean, Hanlon v. Berger has determined that that's not exactly an accepted practice. So understanding what that means and being able to apply the law, we're using technology to bring it more to life. So we are, I'm trying to think of what we're doing next in there. We're talking about news gathering, and actually we're finishing our libel assignment tomorrow. So, you know, I don't teach the law class, which is more of a theory class, the same way that I teach a practical skills class, but I still engage them in their own learning. The classroom environment is still the same. The navigation of learning theory is similar to learning practice, in that you have to be able to come back to me with what you know and not rely on me to give it to you. So I think that if we really start thinking of the end product and what we want the end product to be and what we want them to look like when we're done with them, now we can build assessment that's going to get them there without worrying about each nitty-gritty thing being assessed. Does that make sense? They can't fail if we assess everything. And I mean assess it with points. We have to assess it in terms of, yes, you're making progress. I had a student, her story was terrible. I'll totally admit it. She knows it. She wrote her first article. It had no news value whatsoever. She didn't get the right interviews. She was late to the game. She didn't get the sources that she needed. She wrote a story that was not even serviceable. I mean, technically it was serviceable, but from a news standpoint, it didn't serve any purpose. And she sits there, and she was like in tears. And I said, well, what did you learn? And she's like, well, I learned I need to get started earlier. I need to get better sources. You know, I think I got the writing down, but all these other pieces were missing. And then I learned that even though I put it in the structure, if the content's not there, it doesn't mean anything. I'm like, ding, ding, ding. That's an A effort right there. Like, you may have not gotten an A on this assignment, but you learned far more than someone who probably did. And that's what we have to think about. That's where we're going, is we have to teach them to be responsible for what they learn, and how they learn it, and how they can apply it.
Well, I think what you're saying is highly relevant for this college, because most of our courses in this college, in this building, are small skills classes. I think, though, everything I heard from you and everyone else I asked this question, for David and I, for large classes, I think the long-term answer is a new cottage industry of legions of graduate assistants to do the grading.
Well, I mean,
there's so much grading when you go digital with large classes.
And I totally respect what you're saying, and that's something that we can certainly all explore more. There are ways to do it. I mean, my friend Matt Stoltzfus teaches Introduction to Chemistry. He has like 500 students in there. His course is completely flipped. So, you know, does he have TAs that help him with grading? But the point is not the assessment. I mean, the assessment is similar in the sense that they still need to complete chemistry exams and you know, practical chemistry assignments, but he's not lecturing them. Like, they're doing those activities in class.
Does he use something like Proctor U? Is that how he does the exams?
I'd have to ask him exactly how he does the exam. And we have a whole system that I don't fortunately partake in. I mean, I don't do exams. Now, granted, I have smaller classes. I assume he does, and I, thank God, have not been near chemistry since 1989. But
so you're attempting to make them more responsible for their education, and at the initial stages, unavoidably, they're accountable to you. The idea would be to transition them so that they're accountable to themselves for their own education, and then they're going to keep moving regardless. Do you do anything to work with that transition to get them engaged at that level?
We engage them with each other. So they're actually, in the news writing class, and actually all of my classes, they're put into a team environment. There's 5-member teams, and all of the articles get submitted to that team for editing. So in addition to me editing them, for example, they'll edit them for every project that they do. That group is kind of participating in that educational process. So once they start to recognize that the accountability goes beyond me, they're much more responsive to that sort of guidance and structure. Breaking down their walls, making them feel more comfortable criticizing each other, that's difficult. Our motto in classes, honesty without compassion is brutality. So we move forward with the Celestine prophecy. But, you know, and really, they're also, because we don't do anything that's theoretic in those classes, when they do an interview, in fact, this was a horrible example, but it was useful. I had a student last semester. I inherited a class. We had someone who quit 2 weeks before the semester. And so I inherited his class, and I had to advise. I advised the student newspaper. I taught 5 classes and advised our student media. So we had one student who really thought herself, she was very confident in herself. And she did several interviews, and there were always corrections with her stories. So I said to the guy she was interviewing, I said, I need for you to take notes or do in some way tell me what happens at this interview because there's some breakdown going on. So he ended up recording it. He was our PIO for public safety. He recorded the interview. And she did the interview. She writes the story. And it gets published. I mean, I let it go through. And he ends up writing her an email back and said, this is actually how the interview happened. Verbatim, this is a transcript of our interview, none of which appeared in this article. And that moment when she got that email from him and realized not only did he see it, but all these other people saw it, she's never done it again. So there is no lesson like making yourself available to the public, and that's what we are as journalists, is accountable to the public. Now, there's some people, I'm sure, who would feel like that was a pretty hard lesson to have, but my correcting of her articles over the course of the semester had done very little, and I'm not on the ground with her, and if she's not recording her interviews, I can't say, hey, play me the tape to this, and I can't require that of her. So, you know what? Let's see what happens when your source comes back and says, wow, you really, this is not what I said, and how do you feel about that? And she was mortified. But it's a lesson that she will take with her for the rest of her life, and she will not do again. Oh, I thought you were coming up to greet me. Other questions? Well, I hope this was useful in some way. I really hope that I recognize I in no way profess to have all the answers. Get it, profess. What I do have, though, is really an innate desire to do things better every day. I mentioned to Ed last night at dinner that for the first time this semester, I feel really comfortable with the classes, and everything's moving really smoothly, so I need to change them. I need to do something different now. There needs to be some evolution. And if we can think about that in everything that we do, every day that we teach, if we, especially in what we're teaching, and from those of us who are in media, communication, journalism, we, you know, chemistry has stayed pretty consistent, math stays pretty consistent, they all, you know, change. Nothing changes like we change. And if we're not changing with it, if you can think like you're someone who doesn't want to stay comfortable, you will prepare them to be the people who are going out in an industry that by the time my seniors graduate, this industry is going to be different. And we need to make sure that we prepare them to be those people. Thank you so much for allowing me.
So much. I hope you want to come back. Come back for that. And if some of you want to remain connected to Nicole, we will have business cards that we can trade here at the end. And you'll be available if we have questions at any time, day or night.
Day or night.
Day or night, just like a real journalist, 24/7. All the time.
We can get with Matt, the big chemistry teacher, the C.
We can get with Matt to see what he does for assessment.
For large classes.
That would be good, because I know Robert would be interested in that, and probably David as well. So, anyway, thank you again.
Thank you so much.
And thanks to Jesse.